and kick out these four Phantom Victorias? They
Phantom.
probably overload the server if there are too many.
I don't know
Castle
how to.
Griffin, can you do it?
It says that she's joined and left group chat a couple of times. Joined and
Only
then
says she's
left.
joined it.
Left.
Yeah, she's joined it four times
Yeah, no, I don't know how to kick her out.
without leaving.
Is the when you hover over her picture, William, is does the pull down menu have an option to like remove her?
It doesn't. You know, there was that time that I kicked that other kid out.
Yeah, that guy that came in and swore at us. That was so weird.
But that was totally intuitive, and there was a menu. I mean, I think I just clicked on it, and there was an option for like get rid of it.
Oh, there she goes.
Oh,
She must
just
have closed
suddenly
her computer down.
closed her computer down. All right, let's get started. We'll hope she joins us. We'll hope Bruce joins us. We need volunteers, class. Oh, everyone say hi to Bob, by the way. He's new, and he's only been doing Latin for about 2 years, so be nice to him.
Thanks. Hi, Bob.
Nice to meet you.
Would anyone like to volunteer for 25.3?
Are we? Oh, we are live. Okay.
We're live.
Okay, I can do it.
Okay, that would be great.
Okay, so, Blessed Brendan, Beatrice Brendanus, began to ask that man who he was, or pro qua culpa for what fault he was sent there, or what of blame he had had that he sustained such penance.
Good.
He said to him, meaning the man said to him, I am the very unhappy Judas and the worst traitor, as in trader.
That would be a good pun in English,
It would
but
be
in
a
Latin,
traitor.
he thought he was a
In some
traitor.
varieties of English.
Traitor, right?
Yes, in my English.
I do not have this place because of my fault, but because of the ineffable mercy of Jesus Christ. This place.
I would translate merito merit almost, maybe, or maybe something ambiguous. I think because I think
Because of my deserving or something
right,
like
because it's a good place that he is, or at least it's better than it.
Comparatively.
Right, and I think that's the point. I think it's a positive thing in his mind.
It's in my
Yeah,
fault.
Brendan is thinking, what did you do to get sent
Right.
here?
I don't know why I
And
put
Judas
salt
is
in there.
thinking,
Right.
this is a lot better than hell.
Right.
I was thinking that
Or my
culpa.
dessert,
Because of my desserts, maybe.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's good.
Something like that. But because of the ineffable mercy of Christ, this place is not reckoned as punishment for me, but for an indulgence of the Redeemer, because of the honor of the Sunday resurrection. For then it was the Lord's Day or Sunday. For it seems to me, when I'm sitting here, as if I had been in a paradise of delights because of the fear of torments, which will be for me this evening or on this evening.
Yes, good.
Then he gets graphic. For I burn like a lump of molten lead in a pot day and night. In the center of the mountain, meaning within, I guess, which you have seen,
Right.
the Leviathan with his retinue or his attendants is there.
Good.
I was there when he gulped down, swallowed down your brother. And for that reason, hell was joyful, because hell is strange. So that it had belched forth or sent forth huge flames. And so it always does when it devours the souls of the unholy or of the impious.
Good. Terrific.
By the way, has anyone posted the YouTube link? I don't think anyone has. I don't know exactly precisely how. And my Latin teacher wants to watch it. Salve Magistra.
Does anyone know how to do that?
I thought it was up.
Well, no, the link to joining the session is up, but the YouTube link is not. But I think if I search YouTube...
You might could find us.
Yes, I can find it under Professor Turpin's name.
Or Medieval Latin.
Summer 2014.
Summer Medieval Latin gets lots of calendar girls. It's quite, it goes for Summer Latin. I didn't even know that was a thing. Anyway.
Apparently my computer doesn't like YouTube anymore.
I have the link. I can post it.
Okay.
Oh, thank you. Thank you so much.
All right. Good. Any volunteers for 25.4?
I'll try it. Oh, no, you can do it. No, go ahead.
Okay. Am I being heard?
Yes, we hear you.
Barely.
You're a bit distant.
Okay, yeah. It always does that. Okay, I'll try.
Oh, that's better. That's much better.
Okay, I'll speak like this. I have my rest here every Sunday from morning until night.
From evening to evening.
Okay, that makes sense. And from Christmas up until Epiphany.
Good.
And from Easter up until Pentecost. And from the purification. Oh, and on the purification.
Well, it's the purification and the assumption of the Mother of God, right? Genetrix Dei. Kind of complicated, but of course, there's only one way that it we kind of know what it has to mean.
With right.
Those words like purification and assumption, I think, are so automatically get you thinking about Mary, so it makes it easier to translate the Dei Geneticus.
And honestly, that's a fairly considerable portion of the year for, like, someone who's traditionally the worst person ever to get off of hell.
Right. So he's in this weird... I mean, this is one of the reasons this passage is interesting, is it's kind of this moving towards the doctrine or the idea of purgatory. In this case, he's in purgatory, but only some of the time. So it's like... Mm-hmm.
And it doesn't really have the effect of purgatory, because purgatory is supposed to sort of scrub you clean to get into heaven.
Right.
And
what about clearinghouse?
Right.
Right. But purgatory, I think, at least as far as I understand the doctrine, purgatory is supposed to be where you go before heaven.
Right.
If you go to hell, you just go to hell.
Right.
But if you go to purgatory, you're going to get to heaven eventually.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's not exactly the same, but it's a similar idea of something beyond just heaven and hell.
Right.
Well, of course, purgatory wasn't worked out until about the 12th century,
right.
So this is sort of...
Mm-hmm. Pre-purgatory-ish.
Not really worked out until the 15th, so doctrine-wise.
Oh, yeah?
So, yeah, so this is kind of showing the early, you know, hints of some of the motifs, because Judas is in hell.
Mm-hmm.
There's no other way, you know, to... traditionally to interpret where he is. So this is kind of, you know, sinners are kind of let out. Although there was that tradition too, that even in hell, sinners were given respite for like a Sunday, the Lord's Day.
Mm-hmm. Right, Sunday's off.
Right.
Sunday's off.
All right, keep going, Bert.
Before and afterwards, I am tortured in the depths of hell with Herod and Pilate and Ananias and Caiaphas.
Good.
Wherefore, I adjure you, by the Redeemer of the world, that you deign to intercede to the Lord Jesus Christ that I might have the power to be here up until the rising of the sun tomorrow, lest demons upon your departure torture me and leave me.
I can't hear you. We can't hear you.
And take me off to the bad heritage which I have earned with my the bad price.
Right. Right. So there was something. I may have the power to stay here until the rising of the sun tomorrow, lest the demons in Adwentu Westro at your arrival, right? Advent, torture me and lead me. It does seem like it should be departure, but.
Maybe he means something more like. Because of your arrival, in the matter of your arrival.
Right.
Like, if the demons are mad at him for getting to talk to people or something. I don't really know what the rules are on Sundays Off of Hell.
Right. Good bird, keep going.
St. Brendan said, the will of the Lord be done. This night you will not be a tasty little morsel for demons.
Right, you won't be... It won't be a demon snack. Right?
Demon kibble.
Right. Not until tomorrow.
Can we talk about note 17? About Ananias or Annas?
Right. Sure.
Because I think that that's probably not actually an Ananias. That's probably Annas. Now, Annas and Caiaphas are kind of a pair. You know, they go together like peanut butter and jelly. Annas was one of... He was the sort of ex-high priest that still carried on many of the functions of a high priest. Caiaphas was the high priest.
Right. Okay.
But in Jesus' crucifixion. But I think, for one thing, this looks more like the Latin for Annas than like Ananias. Mm-hmm. And for another thing, he goes with Caiaphas.
Yeah, no, I didn't know that. I never heard of Annas. At least I must have heard of him, but he's went in one ear and went out the other.
Yes. In the Gospels, they took Jesus to him first, and he said, yeah, put him on trial. Mm-hmm. And so they put him on trial before Caiaphas and then before Pilate. Having Pilate there, too, really makes me think it's probably...
Right. No, that makes perfect sense. Thank you very much.
Welcome. The
Jews that were complicit in the death of Jesus. I mean,
right.
Romans who actually carried it out.
Right. Okay.
Next line. Ad malam hereditatem quam comparavi malo pretio. Isn't that? I was thinking it was something like, you know, they'll escort me to the bad inheritance, which I have purchased at a bad price, like a high price.
Mm-hmm. Oh, a high price.
But he's saying it was a bad bargain.
Yeah.
I thought it was just evil, but that's
But especially that compara I was thinking was more the later meaning to buy.
Oh yes.
Or purchase.
I thought Bert got that one.
Maybe I misheard then.
I'll put it actually if you think it's ambiguous, I should I'll put a note in there. But yes, I like the idea of buying it at a bad price or a high price. That seems completely... Mm-hmm.
Just, I think that's what we say in English.
Right, right. Yeah. It seems completely right.
He struck a bad bargain.
Yeah.
A way of getting bad into the English idiom.
Right. But not an evil bargain, just a bad one. Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Good. Thank you both. All right. Okay, Bob, you ready? 25.5?
Okay. Again, the man of God questioned him, saying... what is the meaning of this scrap of clothing, or what does it wish for itself? And he said to him, this piece of clothing I gave to a certain leper when I was the treasurer of the Lord.
Good.
But what I gave did not belong to me. It belonged to the Lord and his brothers. For that reason, I do not have any relief from it, but I have more an impediment.
Mm-hmm.
And the iron forks in which the clothing hangs, I gave them to the priest of the temple for holding up the cooking pots.
Good.
The rock on which I sit, I sent that into a ditch on a public road under the feet of the ones crossing before I had been a disciple of the Lord.
Good. Very good. And this is the time just to say, I read a little bit about the medieval Judas, medieval ideas of Judas. I still haven't found any of this stuff. There's a life of Judas, but it's not in that.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's something that I'm hoping that when this new edition of the Navigatio comes out, we'll get more information about where this stuff is coming from.
I wonder if the golden legend, you know, on other medieval saints' lives, maybe not even under, certainly not under Judas, but you might find it under somebody else.
Yeah, well, Judas is a golden legend, but I think not this story. Not
right.
Sorry, what is the translation of him putting the rock on which I sit?
Yeah.
He threw that into the ditch?
Into the road, isn't it?
Into the ditch.
Into the ditch, right.
On a public road.
Right. Victoria, that was very strange. That was you, right?
Who?
Victoria?
Yes, I can hear everybody, but all I can see is the page of the community. I can't see anybody in the Hangout.
And see, we can hear you, but we can't see you.
Yeah, we have a picture of you and a picture of your camera. Never mind. We can work with that. it's just a little disconcerting, but we'll get used to it.
We're used to having two eyeballs, you see.
And it's I can't believe there's two. It's really strange from here, but
well,
you sound as though you were in an echo chamber. It's all very strange. I mean, it doesn't actually echo, but your voice sounds hollow somehow.
Yeah, different.
Disembodied.
Yes, disembodied. That's what's the matter with it.
Yes, that is exactly what it sounds like. That's what was so creepy. Anyway, so I hope you are right, Victoria.
And that you have not, in fact, been disembodied.
Right.
But if you have, let us know.
But I am bewildered by the rock and the road thing.
Well, especially since it's a big enough rock to be like an island in the middle of the ocean. Right?
Or at least a sandbar sort of deal.
Well, we're told, we're given this description of it, and it's clearly kind of a very small island. As I say, the most obvious place to identify this with is the little island of Rockall. If you ever see you should Google pictures of Rockall. It's just the strangest looking, weirdest, most inaccessible island you've ever imagined. It's like just a lump of rock in the middle of the ocean. There's nowhere to there's no harbor. They can barely land on it. It's British, and they've only ever been on it like once in the 18th century or the 19th century or something. Anyway,
that's hilarious.
It is weird. All right, Bob, great job. Keep going. 25.6.
Okay. But when the evening hour darkened the sea, behold, a countless crowd of demons covered the face of the sea in encircling movement, shouting and saying, go back, man of God, from us, because we are not able to approach our companion until you go from us. And we have not dared to see the face of our leader until we should return to him, his friend. Truly, you have taken from us our morsel.
Mm-hmm.
Do not protect him this night. To whom the man of God said, I do not protect, but the Lord Jesus Christ grants to him or allows him to be here this night until the morning.
Good.
And the demon said to him, in what manner do you invoke the name of the Lord over him? Himself, is it a traitor of the Lord?
Can you say that again? I didn't quite hear it. Just
how do you invoke the name of the Lord over him when he himself is the traitor of the Lord?
Yes, sorry, good.
Okay. To whom the man of God said, I instruct you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ that you do no harm to him or do no wicked things to him until the morning.
And good. Good. Any questions?
Sounds excellent.
Sounds very good.
Is it, I just don't know the answer, is it usual in Christian medieval literature to refer to the sea as Thetis?
I thought that
that
was a very
strikes
cool,
me as odd.
A very cool little classicizing moment.
Mm-hmm. Right? But it seems odd because I'm not sure we have seen any reference to any classical tradition
right,
of that kind.
Right. It is very surprising, it seems to me.
I couldn't help wondering if whoever wrote this had maybe been reading like one of those glossed classical manuscripts and had seen Thetis used for the sea and glossed just as the sea and the goddess bit not explained and just thought it was another word for the sea. You know?
Yeah, that's possible.
If you had learned it just as a name for the sea and not the nymph aspect.
Right.
Because he seems indeed quite to be avoiding classical references that he might make to mythology. Where gods are involved.
Right. It's a good point whether the author knows what he's talking about. I mean the pedestrian answer would be he got it out of Virgil, right? I think Thetis is used for the sea in Virgil. Jen, do you remember?
I don't know.
I feel like the kind of thing Virgil would say. But I think Jamie's point that the author might be completely unaware of it, classical mm-hmm. overtone.
He might have just picked it up somewhere.
Right. And sort of forgot. It's that whole question that of forgetting the origins of a word, the way we do in English as well, so often. I can't think of any examples. But I'm sure in the Middle Ages, they do that a lot. I think this is where we need Bruce and Karen and our experts. It's in Horace. Ovid's Metamorphoses, Virgil's Eclogues. Eclogue 4, in fact, which is the Eclogue 432, it says, which, of course, is the single most important Virgilian text in the Middle Ages. But still, I think Jamie's point is... seems to me exactly right. I wish I knew more about it.
It is in the Aeneid. It's book 5, line 799.
Okay.
But it's a list of, that section appears to be a list of things and isn't a term for the sea in that particular section.
Right. But I think in this author, for him suddenly to get all classicizing is a little odd.
Are there multiple authors here?
Well, there are multiple manuscripts
right.
with multiple versions, which is an answer. But presumably there was originally an author of,
mm-hmm.
I mean, I don't know.
The reason I ask is because I remember that the epithet venerable seemed to come later in the text.
Uh-huh.
And I wasn't sure if that's because there are multiple authors or because St. Brendan became more venerable as the trip.
Oh, I don't know. That's an interesting point.
This is hilarious. I was trying to go to YouTube to look at our video, mm-hmm. to look at the comments page to see if anyone had been saying anything. And it says that this video is unavailable with safety mode enabled. Safety mode. It sometimes will mishear a word, I think, and think you're saying something you shouldn't when it's just that it can't hear right.
I wonder what you said that was so shocking.
Well, that's the thing, is I think it sometimes misprocesses words.
Right. Interesting. I never heard about that. All right. Great job, Bob. Keep going. 25.7?
With that night having been completed, in the first of the morning, I guess at dawn, when the man of God began to make a journey, behold, an infinite crowd of demons covered the face of the abyss, sending out dreadful voices and saying, O man of God, your entry and departure are cursed.
Good.
Because our leader this night whipped us with the most with the worst whips, because we did not present to him this cursed captive.
Good.
The man of God said to them, your curse does not apply to us, but to you yourselves.
Apply, that's good.
Good.
To whom you curse, he is blessed, and to whom you bless, he is cursed. To whom the demons responded, unhappy Judas will endure double punishment in these 6 days because you defended him on this night, on this past night.
Good. Good. Any questions?
I was in the second line where it has maledictus ingressus tuus and there's no verb. I would have taken it as that sit is missing, that it's
so would I.
That it's a wish.
I wasn't sure if it was a command, if it was subjunctive, or he was describing that it was cursed. I wasn't sure.
It seems like a wish to me.
Yeah, I agree. I think if I had to choose between sit and est, I'd go with sit. But of course, since it's not there,
we don't have to choose, do we?
Right. Well,
commentary might want to choose, though.
Right. Yeah. Good point, Jen. I'll make a note of it. This is going to be such a good commentary when it ever gets done. You'll have all this input.
All the crazy things we've all thought of.
I'm not good. It'll at least be right. Then you are. All right. Thank you, Bob. That's great. That's so that's good for, I mean, coming off of, what, 2 years of Latin? That's good.
Excellent.
Good. All right. Jamie, ready for 25.8?
Sure thing. Quibus venerabilis pater dixit, to whom the venerable father said, sorry, non habetis potestatem inde, you do not have power, you all do not have power in that matter. Neque princeps veste, nor your prince or your leader, your head guy, said potestas Dei erit, but the power will be to God. Iterum subjunxit. Then he added, Precipio vobis, I command you in nomine Domini nostri, Jesu Christi, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, et principi vestro, and I command your chief, that's a good word there, ne istum extolatis amplius cruciatibus quam antea, that you do not distinguish, I like that, distinguish this man with greater tortures than before.
Mm-hmm.
Qui responderunt, to whom they responded. Numqui dominus est omnium ut tuis sermonibus obediamus. I just said a random Spanish word there. This is bad.
Yeah.
Are you the Lord of all that we should obey your words? They're basically just being sassy.
Right. Who died and put you in charge?
Yeah.
Who made you God? That would be something that when you're the next time you're having a fight with somebody, you can just say "Num quid dominus es omnium," right? I'm not sure who you can use that line on, but possibly.
All those people. Just be sure that they know that the D is a capital D.
Right. A bossy priest, perhaps. Anyway, keep going.
Quibus virde ait, to whom the man of God replied, Servus suus sum, I am his servant, et quicquid in suo nomine principiam, and whatever I command in his name, inde habeo ministerium, I have power, or I have, not exactly power, it's more, I have an office.
Ministry.
There. Mm-hmm. Yeah, a ministry.
Mm-hmm.
I have a ministry in that matter, de quibus ille mihi concedit, concerning the things which he has, or which he granted to me.
Yes.
So basically, he's saying, I'm not God, but God said this was my business.
Right. I would translate inde as from there.
From there, okay.
Thence I have that responsibility which he entrusted to me.
Okay, I see.
Okay.
It's happening in that matter before, doesn't it? Where you put the note?
Inde?
Mm-hmm. Before, in the first line, where you put the note.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, hello.
Hi.
Hi.
Hey, Bruce. You're right. It did mean it that there, didn't I?
But I think thence makes more sense down here.
Works fine here.
It can have more than one meaning.
Right.
Et ita secuti sunt eum, and thus, or with that, we might say in English, they followed him. I think this is Brendan. I think they're following Brendan, because Brendan's going off. Judas isn't going anywhere.
Mm-hmm.
Usque dum non poterant juram videre. All the way till they couldn't see Judas anymore. Reversi sunt quoque demones. Also, or then the demons went back et levaverunt infelicissimam animam inter illos and carried off that most unhappy soul among them, cum magno impetu et ululatu, with great force, and I want so badly to say hollering.
Go ahead.
And hollering. Because it has the same onomatopoeic effect as ululatu.
Or howling.
Very Texan.
I like hollering.
Right.
Sometimes translating into dialect is easier than translating into standard English.
Mm-hmm. It can irritate other people, though, I warn you. It's never as funny to anybody else. There's a whole tradition of translating Aristophanes into Scottish, which just... hi, Bruce.
Hi.
This is Bob. Say hi to Bob.
Hi.
I think you
hi,
got
Bob.
Your classmates or something. Before we go on... When I was talking about Rockall, just shift it all over to this next island, right? So Judas is on this little teeny tiny rock, right? Which is, again, a big rock to throw into a ditch.
But whatever that's supposed to be about.
But maybe if you called it a boulder, it would make a certain amount of sense. If you rolled a boulder into the ditch, and there he is sitting on it in the middle of the ocean. But he's not on an island, not even an island as small as Rockall. He's just sitting on a rock in the middle of the water, which is kind of weird. Okay, Jamie, 26.1.
William, stop. Before we go on, I'm sorry, that I'm still looking at that inde line with the inde habeo ministerium, and isn't the inde corresponding to the de quibus? Like, I have my office, authority, administrative power from there, from the things, like, from what he conceded to me, so that it, like, because I agree that there was something weird about that de quibus, but isn't that why the inde is there?
If you say so.
I think that makes sense.
I like it.
Where are we?
25.8, line 5. Whatever I order in his name, from there I have. What did you say, Jamie?
I have the ministry, the office.
Right, from the from the things from the things of the people which he
concerning the things. Sure.
Right, concerning the
right, it's not concerning. Yeah.
Concerning.
That made a. Sorry, Jen. What?
I because like when I'm looking at it, it looks like I have it from there, from that group of things. Again, and I want to put another witch in, which is this. You know, obviously, is why the Quibus has been attracted into it, but like meaning something more like part of Ivy than concerning witch. Like I have, maybe it's the Inde that I'm still trying to translate, but like of all the things that, you know, have been, that God has let me do, like that's where I'm getting my power from.
Mm-hmm.
But maybe I'm just belaboring a little bit.
Yes, I think the root meaning here is that he's explaining where he gets his power from.
Yeah.
Or
yeah.
His
mm-hmm.
office. Or I'm not sure I like ministry because it sounds as though he's talking about a specifically pastoral ministry, and I don't think he is.
No.
Ministry more in the sense like the Ministry of Defense in Britain.
Or just...
The area of power, the area of delegated authority. It's delegated authority is what he's talking about.
Mm-hmm.
Anyways, that was probably not relevant.
I have nothing.
I'm just thinking about English usage.
I think this sentence is one you can take a number of different ways, and I think you almost want to go for the one that works best.
Mm-hmm.
So, without resolving that, should we just go forward? 26.1.
If we're ever going to finish,
right.
Probably. Okay, Sanctus Vero Brendanus, that St. Brendan cum suis con militonibus with his fellow soldiers navigavit contra meridianum plagam, sailed towards the northern shore, glorificans Deum in omnibus, glorifying God in all things. Tertia vero die, but on the third day apparuit illis, there appeared to them quaedam insula parva contra meridium proquo, a certain small island far to the north. Cum autem fratres cepissent navigare acrius, but however, when the brothers had begun to sail harder,
mm-hmm.
et propinquascent predicte insulae, and had drawn near to the aforementioned island, ait illis sanctus Brendanus, St. Brendan, said to them, viri fratres, men, brothers, nolite supra modum corpora fatigare. Don't exhaust your bodies more than is reasonable, the medium amount, more than reasonable. Do you think reasonable is a good English? I mean, it's not a direct translation. But we don't really have that idea of the mean, except the golden mean.
Well, it could be limit, right?
The limit? Yes, it could be. Okay, I was taking it as the mean.
The thing with doing is, you know, I mean, instead of exhaust, we could just say tire. So don't tire your bodies, and then either one of those would kind of get to
them. Above the limit. That makes a lot of sense.
Yeah.
Satis enim habetis labor.
What do you say in English, beyond the limit?
Beyond measure.
I like that. Mm-hmm. Beyond measure. Satis enim habetis laborem. For you have enough work.
Mm-hmm.
Septem iam anni sunt postquam egressi sumus de nostra patria. For it's now 7 years since we set out from our homeland. Up until usque in hoc pasca quod venturum erit cito, up until this Easter, which will soon be here. Namque modo videbitis paulum heremitam spiritalem, and soon you will see Paul, the spiritual hermit.
Good.
Okay. In hac insula, sine ullo victu corporali comorantem per...
Sexaginta
annos, thank you. Roman numerals threw me for a loop all of a sudden. On this island, without any corporal victory, without any victory of the body?
Victus is
not victoria, victus.
Ah. Oh, food. What? Oh, without any food of the body. That's a lot more impressive.
Staying, food.
Yeah, staying here, or staying on this island without any food for the body for 60 years.
Yeah.
Nam triginta annos antea sumpsit cibum aquarum bestia. For 30 years earlier, 30 years before that, he ate food from a certain beast.
Right. And I think my notes here are misleading. Bruce has straightened me out. This, of course, this is actually all explained later on when we get the story of the otter and the food delivery service. So for 30 years, the otter would bring him food, and then for 60 years, he just drank this water, which kept him alive. Just, that's just the way it is. Right?
Plankton, maybe.
So it's not he ate out of whatever bestia happened to cross his path.
Right, right, which I think is so maybe what I said.
He literally, yes, as William says, took his home. He took his takeout from a certain beast.
Right.
Okay. Cum autem apropin quasent atlitus. But when they had drawn near to the shore, or had approached the shore, minime poterant aditum invenire prealtitudine ripe ilius. They could not at all find a way in because of the height of the shore. Now, this is Rockall, right?
Yeah, well.
This is the one that is correlated with Rockall. Erat autem parvae nimis rotunda illa insula. That island was small and extremely round, quasi unius stadii, of about one stadium. De terra vero nihil habuit de super. Concerning earth, it really didn't have any on it. Said Petra nuda in modum silicis apparuit, but bare rock appeared in the form of a flint, or in the form of, yes, of a flint, like one giant flint. Quantum erat latitudinis et longitudinis, as much as was its width and breadth, tantum erat et altitudinis, so much also was its height. So it was as high as it was long and wide.
So I'm having a little trouble here, and I'm sure this matters to people who want to read. And we have lots of things. We've had lots of things, you know, that are very symmetrical throughout, right? Remember the columns of the of the ice thing were all exactly the same. But what does this mean? Does this mean there's like a big perfect cube of tofu sitting on a plate-shaped thing? Is that what this looks like?
It doesn't have to be a cube. I would have said it was just 200 yards tall, 200 yards...
across.
And 200 yards. We would say in diameter.
Mm-hmm.
So it's 200 meter yards in diameter and 200 yards tall.
And so it's not square. In other words, it's a cylinder.
That's what I'm thinking.
Or round.
Yes, because it's round.
It could be
rounded off at the top.
Right.
It could be half sphere.
It's a perfect half sphere.
Yes.
Or roughly perfect.
Yeah.
Plenty.
Again, my if you do look at a picture of Rockall, it's pretty hard not to slot it in. I'm not gonna fool with Googling, posting, waving it in your faces, cybernetically speaking, but it explains, at least it gives me my image of what it is we're looking at.
I was, I was thinking more, like Bruce said, that it was a cylinder, because aren't the sides really sheer?
Yeah.
That's the impression I got.
Well, okay, but if you think of half of a basketball, not a basketball, but a football, right, floating in the water, it would be sheer, plenty sheer. The sides of rock are plenty sheer, trust me. Anyway, I mean, again, I haven't been there. I've just seen pictures.
We were at Kumautem Circuisent Navigando Ulam Insulam. Well, that's fine. It was an interesting question.
Mm-hmm.
When they had circled this island or that island by sailing, venerunt portum strictum, ita ut proram naviculae vix capere potuisset, they found a narrow harbor such that the prow of the ship could hardly, or had hardly been able to get into it, basically, to seize it. You know, I wonder, they so often have very narrow and hard-to-find harbors. Mm-hmm. I wonder if that's a nautical parallel to the traditional Christian biblical imagery of the narrow gate or the narrow path being the way to salvation.
Mm.
I wonder if the... Well, I just mean kind of...
Or the camel getting through the eye of a needle.
Right, that... You know, it's narrow, and narrowness being meritorious.
Right. No, I like that. I mean, the worldly, whatever the word is, the anti-spiritual pedant in me would say, of course, on a lot of these islands there are have really small harbors, but
right. But it seems to be emphasized.
Yes, I agree.
I like it.
I'd also like to say, Bird, if you're going to eat cake in front of us, you have to share.
Did you bring enough for the whole class?
There are advantages to not being able to see.
Yeah. All right. Keep going.
Says Sauron.
Right.
Sauron.
Okay, that's kind of creepy now. Et ascensum difficilium ad ascendendum, and an ascent extremely difficult to ascend or to get up. Tum sanctus prandanus dixit fratribus suis, then St. Brendan said to his brothers, expectate hic donec revertar ad vos, wait here until I return to you. Non licet enim vobis intrare, sine licentia viri dei qui comeratur in hoc loco. For you're not allowed to come in, or it is not permitted to you to come in without the permission of the man of God who stays in this place.
Good. All right, any questions? I will leave, we can leave the shape of this island open for, I don't know, book reports. You can all do book reports in the fall.
Maybe it's the shape of the cupcakes Bird is eating.
That's it.
Maybe. That's probably it.
Okay, so Bert. Thank you, Jamie. Bert, can you do 26.3?
All right. But when the Venerable Father had come to the summit of that island, he saw two caves. And the opening of one was opposite from the opening of the other.
Mm-hmm.
And on the east side of the island,
mm-hmm.
and he also saw a little tiny fountain, round like a plate,
mm-hmm.
rising. Or I guess if he's talking about the water coming forth from the rock, mm-hmm. Outside of the opening of the cave where the soldier of Christ was living.
Good.
But where the aforesaid fountain was flowing, at once a rock was absorbing it.
Mm-hmm.
And when Holy Brendan, when St. Brendan had approached to the door of the one cave, the old man came out of the other before him, or opposite him?
Obweam Sibi, Obweam means like in his way, we would say to meet him.
Saying, behold how good and how happy for brothers to live as one.
Good.
And when he had said this, he ordered or asked St. Brendan that he order all of the brothers to come out of the boat. But with hugs and is this some kind of ablative absolute here?
I think so. Although this could be another one of those, it could actually be dative. But I think I took it as an ablative absolute at first. With them kissing each other in turn, right? So I guess you have to supply an ilis if you're going to take it as an ablative absolute. With them kissing each other in turn and then sitting down.
Okay, right. With them kissing, I think the in weekend as well as kissing.
In weekend means one another, right? Reciprocally, right? They kissed him, he kissed them, and then they all sat down.
Okay, so with them kissing each other in turn and sitting down, he called each of them by their own names.
Yes.
But when the brothers had heard him, they were really amazed, not only about his true prophecy, but also about his clothing.
Not only about his prophecy, verum etiam is it's actually a classical expression, but also in truth. So verum can mean but, etiam also, but also about his the way he was dressed, his appearance. So they were dazzled by the prophecy, and I'll add a note to this. It's clear to me now. Throughout this text, one of the things that miraculous holy men do is they know people's names without being told.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that's the prophecy. So they were amazed not only that he knew their name, but also that he looked really weird.
I mean, that makes sense, because in the Bible, for example, when Moses is on Mount Sinai and he wants to know God's name, God doesn't tell him, and the whole deal is that knowing someone's name is a type of power over them, so I guess, yeah, names have power.
Right.
Yeah, but this actually goes beyond that. There seems to be this, and we met this earlier, I think the procurator knew their name.
It's kind of a motif.
Right, that they just get there and they know their names without being having...
Right, and it's not just one person or two people, it's a whole group, right? So it's sort of upping the ante from the Deuteronomic stuff.
Okay.
It is a weird use of prophecy, but it's exactly what it seems to mean.
Right.
That what their prophecy seems to mean... The fact that he knew all those their names without being told, but right. I don't know exactly how to translate that.
Right.
All right. For he was totally covered with his head hairs and his beard hairs and other hairs. We're not going to get into that. down to his
Howard.
And the hairs, they were completely white. Like snow, on account of him being really old.
Being too old.
And
although this author doesn't always seem to know that that's what that actually means.
Right. Yeah, right. Yeah, you're right.
Kind of use it as a comparative.
Yeah.
Intensifier.
And such seemed his face and his eyes.
Tantum, in again, this is classical, but it's tricky. Can also mean only. So just.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. The face and the eyes of him were seen.
Were seen to them. For there was no clothes on him except the hair, which came out over, which covered over his whole body.
Right, he's cousin It. There's actually.
Ew.
There's a great description of an 11th century sort of wandering preacher and holy man, and there's a satirical description of him with his, you know, his beard one way and his hair the other, basically saying you can't tell whether he's coming or going.
Wow,
and that's cool. Clearly what this is meant to be.
I'm not. They don't know who cousin It is.
Oh, William.
Yeah.
There you go.
Are you even more popular culture challenged than I am?
I know who cousin It is.
Oh.
Anyway, what I think is really weird is that Egredier Bantur, the hairs were exiting from
his forward, body. Yeah.
Really odd.
Creepy.
Way.
Creepy. Yeah. Oh, by the way, about that prophecia. If you're looking for a translation, if you want to sort of embrace the Celtic flavor here, you could almost say second sight, because it's more just that he knows things that you're not supposed to know without asking. It's not exactly, I don't know if it's meant to be a divine revelation, specifically of their names, or just that he's, you know, really wise and knows things. So that has sort of the sort of semi-religious flavor
that
it seems to be carrying.
I like that.
Second sight.
Good. Before we go on, there's a misprint in the next sentence. It's not constritatus, it's contristatus. Contristor, which means to be, you know, to take pity on with somebody.
Fortunately, it was glossed.
Oh, right.
Yes.
Something. Okay. Keep going, Bert.
Okay. But indeed, St. Brendan, when he had seen him, was depressed, saying, woe is me, who has the title of monk.
Or the lifestyle, right?
Or just the habit, just the
yeah, the literal habit, the dress.
Who has the habit of the monk, and beneath me are many ordained under that name.
Under the name of that order.
Under the name of that order.
Right. So under me, there have been established many men under the name of that order, namely of being a monk.
Yeah. So here, that's the meaning, right, of, like, under the power of someone, like, under the reign.
Yeah, right.
When I see in the angelic state a man in the flesh sitting here, untainted by the vices of the body.
Yes. When I see now in an angelic state a man in flesh ad hoc, still in flesh, sitting.
Yes, so still in flesh in an angelic state is his contrast.
With sedentem too, right? Still
right.
Sitting
still,
in flesh.
Still being there unwounded, yeah.
Right. Unwounded by vice, the bodily vice. Good.
The angelic. He sounds so unangelic from the description we've just been given.
But he's so holy.
looking.
Mm-hmm. Yes. He's not the Precious Moments angel, that's for sure.
I don't know what that is.
Oh.
But no, I think it's a good point that it really that it contrasts the physical appearance, which is so repellent, and the inner beauty.
Mm-hmm.
Very quite powerful. Keep going, Bert.
To whom
the man of God, and this man of God presumably is not a hermit, to whom the man of God said, "O venerable father, how many and what awesome types of miracles God shows to you," which he made manifest to none of the holy fathers.
Good.
And you say in your heart that you are not worthy to wear the habit of a monk, although you are greater than a monk. Indeed, a monk is clothed and
supplied, maybe?
And supplied by the labor of your hands.
Well, Utor takes an ablative, remember? So I took this to be the monk, in fact, uses the labor of his hands. And he is clothed.
So do you take it there's kind of a missing in day? God help us.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So the monk uses the labor of his own hands and is clothed.
Right. Right.
Okay. It was strange.
It's a strange way of putting it.
I expected this to have what you might expect to have there is a monk eats and is clothed by his own hands, but that's not what I expected completely. There's really no way that can be what this means.
Okay. But God, of his secrets, for 7 years, fed you and clothed you with your monkly family. But I sit a miser, just like a bird in his nest, naked except for my beard, or except for my hair.
Not like a miser, which is actually, the word for miser is avaris in Latin.
Or poor.
Miserable.
A wretch.
So poor, miserable me, I sit like a bird on this rock.
So basically poor me. Ego miser is poor me.
Exactly. Poor, miserable me. Does anyone get what the de sui secretis are? God feeds you through 7 years.
Out of his mysteries, I think.
Out of his mysteries.
Yeah.
Okay.
I agree.
I'm not sure. I mean, which would mean as one of his mysteries.
Sort of, yes. Yeah. But it's also sort of out of his secret places, his secret storehouses, his mysterious resources. God moves in a mysterious way his wonders to perform.
Right. I like the secret resources.
Yeah, I think that, yeah.
I never thought of God having secret resources.
He has them all the time.
Well, read the Old Testament. God's got whole other worlds that he's
resources. It's like a place where he goes and gets stuff. Like I'll just go back and top up on Thunderbolts.
Yes. Well, of course that's an image, but it is a very powerful image.
Yeah. Yeah. I wonder if it's a Vulgate phrase, the De Sui Secretis.
It could be. It sounds like it. It sounds like the Psalms is what it sounds like to me.
Yeah. Thank you, Bert.
If I dared to touch my keyboard again, I'd go look.
Okay.
A comment about the hermit's appearance.
Mm-hmm.
How he's living for so long unharmed. It reminded me of that description of the candle, which was corporeal, but it burned spiritually. And I thought that was kind of important for this story because they seem to be in this intermediate place between the corporeal and the spiritual.
That makes sense. Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's and just providential supply that isn't natural. That's a major theme here.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah. Yeah, this is a stupid time to mention it, but at some level, this text is clearly way deeper than we've gotten to, right? There's a lot going on that
there's a whole level of symbolic meaning.
Yeah. But as someone who's not unable to read Pilgrim's Progress, I'm not the person to draw those symbolic meanings out.
I'm not seeing De Suis Decretis anywhere on a Perseus search. Google comes up with a couple results for it that aren't this text, but they're later.
And the Vulgate doesn't. You said you did Perseus?
I did Perseus.
Yeah, so that probably would have given us the Vulgate, right?
Yeah, the Vulgate's definitely on there.
Yeah. All right, thank you, Bert. Any other thoughts as we go on? Victoria, disembodied voice.
Then St. It's sort of appropriate somehow. Then St. Brendan questioned him about his coming, presumably there, or whence he was from, had been from, for how much time he had been sustained there, he had sustained such a life there.
Yeah, or even like endured.
Endured.
Been able to sustain, like, endure. How long have you been able to stand this treatment?
Oh, but it's joyous and worshipful, yes?
Well, yeah, except that he isn't eating anything and he looks like a freak.
But he's a hermit. He likes that, presumably. Or at least he rejoices in it.
Yeah. No, that's right. In all seriousness, that's right.
But it is quite possible that he's rejoicing in his sufferings. You know, that is something we're commanded to do. So.
Right.
It's not like, yay, I get to wear nothing but my hair for 60 years or 90 years or however long it was.
Right.
To the glory of God. To whom that man responded.
And Pantene. To the glory of God and Pantene.
Except it is all white.
That's what's coming up from the fountain. I was raised in the monastery of St. Patrick for 50 years, and I took care of the cemetery of the brothers.
It's a cheerful job.
What's that?
It's a cheerful job, uplifting.
Well, it only gets better from there. But on a certain day, when my dean had designated to me or pointed out to me the place of a grave for a certain dead person so that I might bury him, so that I might have buried him.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
There appeared to me a certain unknown old man who said to me, "Forbear, brother, to make this ditch, because it is the grave of another." To whom I said, "Father, who are you?" He said, who said then, "Why, do you not know me? Do you not know your abbot?"
Wouldn't that be, "Am I not your abbot?"
"Am I not your abbot?" To whom I said, "St. Patrick is my abbot." But he responded, I am he. I have come from a past or a yesterday generation."
I think just yesterday, I emigrated from the world.
Yesterday, I left this world.
Right.
Okay. For this is the place of my grave.
Yeah.
Is there an extra may I there? Is only one of them supposed to be there?
May I sepulture may?
Mm-hmm. That's what I have, a question mark, too.
I didn't even notice that. 26.
Focus may I sepulture I may. I didn't notice that either.
My place of my grave or something? I mean, if it's his...
But it couldn't be locus may I. That doesn't make any sense.
Yeah, that was
this place of my grave.
Wow, I didn't notice that twice.
And our author doesn't write may I usually.
Right.
Anyways, he writes may. So I believe the may and not the may I.
So the Selmer has ipse est enim locus sepulturae mei. Is that the right
sentence? Yes, that makes a lot more sense.
Mm-hmm. Ipse est enim
may locus. A or may I?
May A, I would think.
Ipse est
enim. Because he writes sepulturae.
Sepulture mei. Yes, the mei shouldn't be there. Thank you, Jen.
Yep.
Keep going, Victoria.
So here you make
Fakiesis.
Mm-hmm.
Dance.
What's that? Here.
Not Fakis.
It's a command, I think.
Ooh. She one correction and she crashed.
What now? Here you're making the grave of your brother.
Yeah, it's future. Is he's
Focky Ace, yeah.
Right, we're being all teacherly. We're getting psyched up for the semester. We're doing that thing, right? But we should just say it's future. You will make the grave.
Here you will make the grave of your brother.
Our
brother. And you will say to no one what I have said to you.
Good.
Moreover, tomorrow you will go down to the shore of the sea and you will encounter a little boat there.
Good.
In which you will enter, or which you will enter into, and it will lead you, which will lead you to the place where you will await the day of your death, or you will expect the day of your death.
Good. Good.
To answer the question of did St. Patrick found a specific monastery, I didn't do very thorough research here, but one possibility may be that this is a monastery for whom, whose patron saint was Patrick.
Right.
So this is Patrick. So I don't know.
I think it would be Armagh, wouldn't it?
It could be Armagh. The thing is that the chronology gets scrambled here because this guy says he's, you know, been sitting on this island 90 years, and if St. Brendan thinks he lives when we think he lives, it's very confusing.
I would think Patrick's followers, since Patrick was a bishop, would have founded monasteries, but I don't recall any that Patrick himself.
No, I couldn't find it myself either. Yeah.
Well, couldn't this just be kind of a bit of name-dropping, where maybe Patrick made his way into the story in place of somebody else because Patrick is famous and the other guy wasn't?
Well, actually, there's one theory about Patrick is that a lot of things are attributed to Patrick that maybe should be divided between Patrick and his predecessor, missionary bishop. So we may be dumping a whole lot onto Patrick, mm-hmm. which is not specifically Patrick's.
Right.
The most fun thing about Patrick is you can enjoy telling your students that he was English, not Irish.
Right.
Welsh, really.
All right, and some of us say he was Roman, but never mind.
Glasses, as we say.
Keep going, Victoria.
So, in the morning, following the order of the Sacred Father, I went down to the appointed beach, or the aforementioned beach.
Mm-hmm. Mm. Appointed, that's good.
And I encountered, just as I encountered, presumably, the boat, just as he had told me I would.
Good.
When then I embarked on the boat,
That's another clue perfect for you.
That's another, when I had embarked upon the boat.
Yep.
I began to sail for 3 days and three nights. And with these done, or with these things over, I sent the boat wherever the wind had wished to throw it.
Yes, to toss it.
Toss it.
Drive it.
Toss it.
Mm-hmm.
And in turn, on the seventh day, this rock appeared, mm-hmm. in which I immediately entered, the boat being sent away and being struck by my foot. So I have no idea really what Eoset is, but so that it might go whence it had come.
Yeah, Eoset looks like it's from Ale.
Yeah. But imperfect subjunctive.
It's imperfect subjunctive.
Eoset. Eoset.
That V gets dropped.
Right. It's an alternate form, right?
Strange in this particular form.
It really is funny looking, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
And it seems like the only time he's using the pluperfect when you're supposed to be is in cum clauses. Like, everywhere else, it should not be pluperfect.
Right.
Yep. He uses the pluperfect way too much.
Indeed.
By classical standards.
But the cum clauses are right. Those are good.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Everything else is wrong.
That's why when you get to the ones that are wrong, yeah. It's just so jarring. It's like, oh, no.
I as a medievalist, I hate to say this, but these just look wrong to me.
right.
But the sense here is so that it might go whence it had come.
Yeah.
I think so.
Mm-hmm. So that it
yep. would. Yep.
Okay. Immediately I saw it plowing the waves with the most rapid course. Hare Ikora lost that one.
Ikora, does that help?
Right.
No.
Over the waters.
Through the sea, plowing... Yeah. Plowing a great, most rapid course through the waves, through the sea, so that it would return to the fatherland, its fatherland.
Fatherland.
Right.
I love that an avicula has a fatherland.
Suam. but I remained here.
As you can see.
around the ninth hour, an otter brought me food from the sea, that is, a fish, one fish in his mouth, and a bundle from brushwoods for the making of a hearth, for the making of a fire. It brought between its front paws, walking upon its two, above its two hind paws.
Yes.
Yep.
When he had put before me the fish and the grasses, he returned whence he came, like the boat.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know where he got the iron, but taking up iron, struck a flint and made fire from the grasses and prepared food for myself from that fish.
Oh, good, he's cooking it. I was worried he wouldn't.
Very civilized.
But you say sushi is uncivilized now.
Oh, good point.
I have Sorry, Victoria. The gramina, is that the same thing as the fasciculum de Sarmentis?
I was assuming it was another way to refer to that, but is it not?
I don't know. I think it probably is, but you know, but the one really does mean twigs, and the other really does mean usually doesn't mean grasses.
Isn't this an example of something that I think we, or couldn't it be an example of something that I think we talked about last year? Somebody posted about it last year, and it was very interesting. I don't remember who though. About how medieval Latinists would learn words from glossaries, and they would just be glossed, you know, with close Latin words. Mm, so they would have a lot of synonyms, but they would not necessarily know the fine distinctions because of the way that they learned vocabulary.
Yeah, no, that would make sense. I mean,
could this be a case of that?
I think this could be a case of that, and I was trying to think, wait, is that another course for his meal? Because we've talked about them having, you know, herbos to eat a lot. They seem to eat a lot of salads on this journey, but that doesn't seem to be what this is here.
Well, he ignites them in the next...
He's
not going to eat them.
Right, it's not food. And so I think I think the gramina has to be the same thing as the sarmenta.
Sarmenta, yeah.
Weeds.
Okay, thank you.
All right, should we go for any other issues?
Another question. Do you think this is a reference to, is he referencing Eve here, the wife of Cuthbert?
There's otters involved in
that as well, isn't there? Mm-hmm.
Sorry, otters involved in what?
In the wife of Cuthbert. That's another Celtic saint.
Mm-hmm.
Boy, I don't remember.
I'm not familiar with the life of Cuthbert, I'm afraid.
Cuthbert is later.
He's an English saint, but it doesn't matter.
Later than Brendan, but not necessarily. But I don't think the life of Cuthbert is not necessarily later than this.
Right. Sorry, I wasn't thinking. Yes, good point. I do remember an otter, but
there are a lot of animals in that thing.
Right. All right, Victoria, should we go on? 26.8.
Thus, through 30 years, always on the third day, that same minister, the same food, that is one fish, brought toward the 3 days. So, heavy emphasis on the 3 days here. The third part of the fish, I ate on every day, and there was nothing of thirst for me through the grace of God.
Mm-hmm.
But on Sunday, on the Sunday there came out a little water from that rock, whence I was able to take a drink and fill my vessel for the work of my hands, for washing my hands, for the need of my hands.
Good.
After about 30 years, I came upon those two caves and that fountain.
Mm-hmm.
For indeed, I live, or from them I live, and after almost 60 years without any other food, any other nutrition or food except from this fountain.
Literally without the nutrition of another food except. Mm-hmm.
Except from this, okay.
Right.
For indeed, I am 90 years in this island, 30 years in the nourishment of fish, and 60 years in the support and the nurturing and the food of that fountain, and 50 years I was in my fatherland.
Good.
All the years of my life up until just now are 140.
Yep.
Wow.
And here, here I ought. Mm-hmm. I'm not sure how to quite. Here I ought to do this way, or I ought to be this way, just as.
Again, this motto is again now, right?
Right.
Or is it in? No, I think it's now. Now, in the sense of maybe still.
And the debeo is with expectara. I ought to wait.
I ought to.
Here I ought to, just as was promised. Oh, so here I ought to wait, just as was promised or told to me. Wait the day of justice in this flesh. Wait judgment day in this flesh.
Exactly.
Right.
William's second line from the bottom. I've just noticed Quin Gaginta. Is that right?
Oh, I think that should be a Q.
Oh, right. It
would be a Q-U or just a Q.
Q-U, yes, thank you. Queen Quaginta.
So is he saying that he's not going to die until Judgment Day, and presumably not then, because on Judgment Day it's a bit late?
Well, it looks like.
Well, I wondered if motto just really means now, and here I ought to wait now.
But expectare diem judici in ista carne. To wait for the judgment day in this flesh strongly suggests not dying. And such legends are, you know, extremely common.
Yeah.
There used to be a legend that the Apostle John would not die until the judgment day, and not then either, based on some, you know, misinterpretation of something Jesus said in the gospel.
Okay.
So yeah, that just was what made me...
Yeah, but it is sort of strange that it's all of a sudden now he's going to wait for the day of judgment after this very specific 140 years. Again, maybe, I think you'd have to look at a lot of the numerological stuff in this whole text to begin to guess what's
right. What. But I do get the sense that these are, you know, complete numbers, you know, adding up to 90 and all. He's been there 90 years. 90 years is a good... you know, round number that often provides a transition. So I guess he's saying now I've you know, passed the test or something, and I just have to wait here is almost the sense I'm getting. But motto is used so strangely in this text that I'm not sure I can pin it down.
Yeah, I really think motto.
Well, yeah. Google just told me that Job lived for 140 years.
Oh.
And Job being the type of patient
yeah.
Endurance.
Yeah, really.
Wasn't Noah really ancient?
Oh, Noah was much older than that.
Noah's probably 5,000 years old.
No, not 5,000. No, several hundred, though.
Yeah.
Because you remember by Bishop Usher's calculation, the world was only about 6,000, according to the genealogies taken strictly.
Yep.
Right.
So not 5,000, but maybe 500.
Yeah,
but the idea of the sense then is sort of here I'm supposed to now wait.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And it's not anything I know very much about, but didn't a lot of people think the day of judgment was imminent?
Yeah.
So it's not
yeah.
like he's going to wait another 1,000 years or something.
Right? Oh yeah, no, absolutely right. I mean, this is a strain of thinking that's extremely strong in what we'd call late antique.
Mm-hmm.
Thought, at least sort of 5th through 7th century, I would have thought it was less strong by the time we get to the time, not of Brendan's lifetime, but the composition of this text. But no, absolutely, the imminence of the imminence of Judgment Day was really was very much in the forefront of the minds of a lot of folks in the very early Middle Ages.
Okay, cool. Ken, you ready to go on? Thank you.
Sure.
Thank you, Victoria.
Thanks, Victoria.
Excellent.
Pergite igitur ad patriam vestram. Therefore, continue on to your fatherland. Et vobiscum asportate vascula plena de isto fonte. And bring with you full vessels of water from this font, this spring. Necesse enim erit vobis, for it will be necessary for you you'll need it. Quia ad huc restat iter vestrum per quadraginta dies, because your journey still remains for 40 days. You still have 40 days to go. It est usque in sabbatum pasque.
That's really kind of strange syntax there.
Yeah.
Sort of almost complete thought, comma, almost complete thought.
Yep. That is all the way until the Sabbath of Easter. Celebrabitus vero sabbatum sanctum et pascha, atque sanctus dies pascae ubi celebrastis per sex annos. But you will celebrate the Holy Sabbath and Easter and the holy days of Easter, where you celebrated them for the last 6 years, et postea, and afterwards, accepta benedictione procuratoris vestri, with the blessing of your steward having been received, profisce mini ad terram repomissionis sanctorum, you will set off for the promised land, et ibi manebitis quadraginta dies, and you will remain there for 40 days. Et post haec, Deus patrum vestrorum ducet vos, sanus atque in columnes, and after these things, the God of your fathers will lead you, healthy and unharmed, in terram nativitatis vestrae, into the land of your birth.
Good.
That was a spoiler.
True. Does anyone know or care why suddenly he's the God of your fathers? I mean, I take it it's biblical, God of our fathers.
Oh, very.
Hand, but why God of your fathers? That seems odd.
I think it might be a reference to the terram nativitatis. You know, that they're returning to the land of their birth, the land of their fathers, the land of their families.
Mm-hmm.
So it could just be an association of ideas there, where it's like the God who has always protected your families in this place, your ancestors in this place, will protect you back to that place.
Yes, that's plausible. Yeah.
Because they're Irish and he's not.
Yeah, that's sort of what it sounds like.
Right.
So what, the Irish have dibs on God?
Well, no.
Oh, of course.
I mean, but that he's just saying you are,
right,
and then you're God. I don't know. Okay.
Yeah, I do see that structure.
All right. Leaving aside these ethnic claims.
Just
chapter 27 onwards, Jen.
Okay. Igitur sanctus Brendanus cum suis fratribus. Therefore, St. Brendan, along with his brothers, accepta benedictione viri Dei, with the blessing of the man of God having been received, quaeperunt navigare contra meridiem, began to sail toward the south, per totum quadragesimae tempus, through the whole time of Lent, et ferebatur huc atque illuc illorum navicula, and their little boat was carried this way and that, et erat illis cibus tantum aqua, and there was for the only food they had was water.
Mm-hmm.
The
mm-hmm.
water quam, the water which ac caperunt ab insula viri Dei, which they received from the island of the man of God. Per triduum reficiendo sine ulla esurie et siti, eating every third day without any hunger and thirst, permanentes laeti omnes, everyone remaining happy.
That's nice.
I think it's Red Bull they're drinking, myself.
It's what they're drinking?
Red Bull. That's the only way to account for the good mood. They're caffeinating out of their mind.
Wouldn't they be irritable?
Well, it depends, William.
All right, onward. Okay. Jen, 27.2.
Tunc, then, secret praedixerat viri Dei, just as the man of God had predicted, had said beforehand, venerunt ad insulam praedicti procuratoris in sabbato sancto. They came to the island of the aforementioned steward on the Holy Sabbath. Et ut venevant ad portum, and when they got to the harbor, occurrit illis obvium cum gaudio magno. He ran to meet them with great joy. Omnesque de navi levavit proprius brachiis, and he lifted up all of them from the boat with his very own arms.
Mm-hmm.
Per acta vero divino officio die sancti, and with the divine office of the holy day having been completed, op posuit coram eis canam, he placed dinner right in front of them.
Good.
Facta vero jam vespere, and when it had become evening time, ascendelunt naviculum, they went into their boat, et idem vir cum illis, and the same man went into the boat with them.
Good.
Is that vespere the vesper service, when the vesper service had been completed?
That seems reasonable. Because
you wouldn't exactly say when evening was completed, or do they mean just at nightfall? I'm a little confused.
I thought it was, I mean, obviously the way I translated it, I thought it was evening because it was Theo.
Right. That's what I thought. But you're the medieval ritual guy, Bruce.
Well, but it's evening facto. I mean, it's an ablative absolute, right?
Right. But is Vesper, singular Vesper, how you talk about what we would call Vespers?
I say feminine and plural.
I think Vesperi is what I've heard, but it's just what I've heard, I think, in my memory.
Now I'm not sure.
Oh, well.
Now I'm just not sure.
Okay. I was fine with it just being evening. And I wasn't bothered by the facto, right? Because as Jen says, it could be Theo, night having taken, evening having taken place, having become evening. Right?
As opposed to evening having been finished or having been made.
Right.
So I'm splitting hairs.
Right, but I do think if you think of it as coming from Theo, then it's less problematic.
Yeah, no, that's right.
All right, Jen, I do apologize, by the way, for these really long pages that you guys have, but that's how we're getting done. On top of that, Jen, I apologize, this isn't a very exciting passage. But
that's okay.
What could be more exciting than medieval church ritual?
Well,
the guy with the long hair was pretty excited.
That was right.
The otter on his head.
The red bull coming out of the rock.
Right. I mean, the otter is downright cute. Okay. Yeah.
Walking like people. Cum autem navigasent, but when they had sailed, in venerunt bellum, statim in solito loco, they found the beast immediately in his accustomed place. Et ibi laudes deo canto vivant, tota nocte, et missas mane. And there they sang praises or lauds to God the whole night, and they sang masses in the morning. Finita vero missa, but with the mass having been finished, coepit Jasconius ire in suam viam. Jasconius began to go on his way. Et omnes fratres qui cum sancto Brandano erant, coeperant clamare ad dominum dicentes, and all the brothers who were with St. Brendan began to cry out to the Lord, saying, exaudi nos Deus, salutaris noster. Hear us, O God, our salvation. Face omnium finium terrae et in mari longae, the hope of all the territory of the land and the hope on the sea far off.
Good.
Sanctus Brendanus confortabat suos fratres dicens. St. Brendan was comforting his brothers, saying, nolite for nadare, don't be afraid. Nihil enim mali erit vobis, for nothing bad will happen to you.
Good.
said adiutorium imminent itineris, but a helper for our journey is at hand.
Good.
Recto corsu bello appervenit usque ad litus insulae avium. By a direct course, the beast arrived all the way at the shore of the island of the birds. Ibique demorati sunt usque ad octavus Pentecostem, and there they stayed all the way till the octaves of Pentecost.
Mm-hmm. I don't think I'd quite realize that they were being transported by the whale.
Yeah, I'm not sure that's happened before. I think this is a different Jasconius experience previously. Because did the steward go with them before? He went with them this time. Did he do that before?
Well, we're clearly in kind of wrap-up mode, so the steward now joins them. I think that's...
Right. So this is a different experience, because they're being taken by Jasconius, apparently, I guess, to the Promised Land.
Well, to the Bird Island.
Oh, yes, the Island of Birds. I forgot about the birds.
But we're not told kind of how... Are they in the boat attached to the whale? Are they on the whale with the boat?
And isn't that what they do? They land their boat?
Right, they land their boat. But, it's a little vague, right? They found the island, they found the beast in his usual place. And then Jasconius began to go on his way. And the brothers all began to shout, saying, help, help. And then they're at the other island. It's all a little mysterious. And I don't think I'd quite register that before.
Well, they must have the boat with them because they're talking about it in the next paragraph.
Right. They get in the boat next paragraph and go on. So they must have their boat. But I just...
Beached on the back of the whale.
Yes.
Right. Beached on the back of the whale. Sure.
Okay, we've seen that on YouTube. It can happen.
Right?
Mm-hmm. That's true.
I kept thinking of harpoons, but that's wrong. Like in Moby Dick, don't they? The whale drag them along for a long time?
Yes. We do not stab Jasconius with harpoons.
Right. No, that would be terrible.
That would be extremely...
Just set a fire on his back.
Yeah.
All right, Jen, one more. 27:4.
Transacta iam tempore solemnitatem. And with the time of the ritual observances having passed, procurator qui cum illis erat dixit Sancto Brendano, the steward who was with them, said to St. Brendan, ascendite maliculam et inflate utres fonte isto. Get in your boat and fill your skins, your water skins, from that fountain. Ero namque socius itineris vestri, ista vice atque ductor. For this time, I will be the companion of your journey and the leader. Mm-hmm. Is it ductor because, like, in the medieval period, dux was taken?
Don't you think it just means guide?
Yeah.
Right.
Someone...
But as opposed to using dux for that? To give it more of a guiding sense rather than leading?
Yeah. Okay. Don't you think dux really means commander, surely? And by this period, it means duke. Yeah.
Exactly. That's what she's saying. It's taken.
Right.
Right.
But in classical Latin, Jen, you wouldn't say dux for leader.
I wouldn't say ductor either, so...
Right. Okay.
I didn't look it up, but I don't feel like this is a word I know, so. But I didn't look it up, so.
Yeah, it does have the air of being sort of a nonce word made for the occasion.
It seems like a really good word for a person who leads someone somewhere
perfectly. It does, but
I
can't place it.
I think unlike most Latin words, it makes perfect sense to me. But
conductor, so...
Whether it's classical...
Yeah, conductor.
It means, you know what? This is interesting. It doesn't mean guide in the way that I thought it meant. At least in classical Latin, it means military commander, or it means helmsman.
Oh,
which of course
that makes perfect sense in this context.
So
this is why you should look words up.
I know, but
I know.
You're so right. William didn't look it up. You didn't look it up. I didn't look it up. We didn't look it up.
Yeah. Right.
No.
Okay.
You know, you think like, oh, I've been doing this for 25 years. I don't need to look those words up, but you do.
That's just, it's never, ever. William?
Yes.
Right? It's never, ever true.
I know, but it's...
You just have to keep looking up doggone words as long as you live.
True. All right, on that sad note, keep going, Jen.
Sine me non poteritus in venire terram repromissionis sanctorum. Without me, you will not be able to find the promised land. Ascendentibus autem navem, with them getting in the boat, omnes aves quae in illa insula erant, quasi una voce dicebant, all the birds that were on that island, as if with one voice, were saying, prosperum iter faciet vobis deus salutarium nostrorum. The God of our salvation will make a successful journey for you all.
Yeah, good.
Then I am quite surprised that you didn't question the comma after Navem and try to convince us that Ascendentibus was in fact a dative.
The subtext here is he thinks it's a dative.
Subtext here is because you've alerted us to this more than once I thought of it.
It certainly could be a dative. You know, there was a comma.
All the birds that were in the island as if in one voice said to them embarking.
Yeah, while they were getting on their boat.
Getting on the boat.
Right.
Yeah.
That's certainly a good classical construction. But personally, I think that we get a lot of these ablative absolutes with mm-hmm. them doing something where you do supply the pronoun. Right?
Yeah. But Janice mm-hmm. called our attention in more than one case to someplace where, you know, a dative really might be the better choice.
I know.
Although the fact that it's a good classical construction tends to make me question its applicability to this text sometimes.
Right. Right.
This is a very insular medieval text, isn't it?
I agree.
More than classical.
I think most of the other ones that I wanted to be dative were with verbs meaning to meet, like occurrit.
Sorry, meaning what?
To meet, like occurrit.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, right. No, those are very clear. But I think there have been other... I just have to go look at all the things. It could be either dative or ablative plural. But there have been others where you've suggested, you know what, and really been... Yeah, you've raised a good point.
Mona seems to have left us right at the moment when we need her.
Oh no, Mona!
I'm going to invite her back in case that's.
Come back.
I mean, she may have other fish to fry.
Does everyone else say when William does that in some kind of vaguely threatening way, William has invited somebody outside Swarthmore WEDU into this conversation?
Like you know, look out.
We're about to let someone of the wrong kind into the social club.
Mm-hmm.
Those awful.
We're crossing boundaries.
I know, people. Never mind. Don't get me started. So, class, remaining class, we have suddenly unseen translation to be done right at the crucial moment, right when we get to Ohio, or not.
How did you come up with Ohio?
I posted the reference.
Yeah. Yes, give us the scoop on the Ohio. What makes him think it's Ohio?
Well, you land in America, and you go for a while, and you come to a river. I mean,
folks have seen Field of Dreams, right? It's great.
I actually think the Mississippi works great, right? It's half of the promised land, but you can't go to the other half.
Yeah, it's the Monongahela. It's one of the rivers on one of the sides of Pittsburgh.
Right. So so paradise is the other side. Anyway,
if they didn't go that far, it could be the Schuylkill.
I could swear. But in 28.2, don't they go around? Don't they circum whatever the whole island?
Yeah.
They do.
Well, if it were North America.
Good point.
Damn big island.
that you can't sail around.
No, that's correct.
But I think they go around it. They just go around the land on foot. They're not circumnavigating in 28.2. I don't think. Anyway, let's translate it and see with all of this excitement.
Well, all right. Should you and I do it?
Should we do it?
Don't you? We keep threatening to do it, and then somebody volunteers, and so isn't it our turn to make fools of ourselves?
Yeah, let's hear the professor.
Our students like doing it. Anybody want to do it, class?
Go for it.
I think you should do it.
Because the section after this is empty, too, so there's lots to come.
All right, trade sentences, William.
You want to, no, let's do you do a section, I'll do a section. You go first.
Sancta Sprendanus, et qui cum illo erant navigaverant ab insulam procuratoris, et ipse cum illis. Ibique sump serunt dispendia quadriginta dierum. St. Brendan and those who were with him sailed to the island of the steward's island. And he, meaning the steward, along with them, he sailed along with them. And when they were there, they took up supplies, let's say, for 40 days. Good. Literally 40 days, supplies of 40 days. Mm-hmm. Erat altum navigiaeorum contra orientalem plagam quadraginta dierum. Their journey... toward the east was of 40 days. They had a 40 days journey toward the east. Poro ipsa procurator illorum antecedebat eos et illorum iter dirigebat. And here's the next thing you need to know, that steward himself went their steward himself went before them, and he something like guided their pathway, guided their journey. Mm-hmm. William's note says he went up to the prow, which I think is perfectly possible. But you'll also remember, see, William, I'm stealing this. He always had his own little boat that he brought stuff in, and they got in his own little boat, and then he went back wherever I came. So I think there's a possibility here that he's actually going before them in his own little boat.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I'm not sure, but I just want to suggest that as a possibility.
I like it.
Transactis vero diebus quadraginta vispera imminente. Hoberet eus caligo grandis. And when the 40 days had passed, when evening was upon them, when evening was overhanging, I'm taking this as meaning like maybe thick, I wasn't quite sure what to think of grandis, a thick fog covered them. It ut vix alterum potuisso videre, such that one of them could scarcely see the next. Procurator altum ait sancta bene Brendano. The steward then said to St. Brendan, Scitus quae est ista caligo? Is that caligo or caligo?
Caligo,
yeah, I thought so. Scitus quae est is the caligo. Do you know what this fog is?
Mm-hmm.
Sanctus Brendanus ait quae est. Sanctum Brendanus, St. Brendan said, what is it? Tunc iet ille. So he said, meaning, procurator said, Ista caligo cercuit illam insulam quam quaeritis per septem annos. This fog encircles that island which you're looking for, as William says, a historical present, really, which you've been looking for 7 years, through 7 years, for 7 years.
Yeah, Latin, I wouldn't, would you call that a historical present when it's that present continuous perfect thing, like you have been doing something?
Up to the present.
Which Latin does use the present for, but could you call that a historical present?
Well, I did, but what would you call it?
I called it a continuous present perfect thing. I didn't know what to call it.
Continuous present.
I like continuous present perfect thing. Probably Alan Greeno has something.
I'm sure there's a better name, but it's like the I've been doing, and you do use the present.
I'm not sure it's a better name. It's probably just a stiffer name.
Yeah.
Which you have been and are searching for.
That's what it really seems to mean, doesn't it?
Yeah, but that's not a historical present.
No, all right.
No.
Thank you.
Yeah, because you are still searching for it.
I wish I had a real name for it.
Right, but no.
Now I'm thinking I think it may be some liturgical theme or a piece of a liturgical drama involving the nativity. Quem queritas Domine, somebody's talking to the Magi, and it definitely means, who are you looking for and who have you been looking for? Because we know the Magi have been trailing across the desert following the...
I think that's the ladies, that's the ladies that play, that's the ladies at the tomb. I think that's actually an authentic present.
Oh, sorry, that's a present.
Right.
Okay.
I'm pretty sure that's that famous mystery play that I read. I read it in college a zillion years ago. Anyway, or at least I have a memory of reading it in college, and I have a memory of it being, you know, what do you call that? That scene. What's the scene at the tomb? Is there a name for that? The women at the tomb. Does that have a name?
That's how I would describe it.
Oh, okay. All right. That's best I can do. Then we can do. All right. Keep going, Bruce.
Post spatium unius ore iterum circumfulsit eos lux ingens, et navis stetit ad litus. So after the space of 1 hour, again, a great light illuminated them, right? Brightened around them. And the ship stood at, or maybe even on, the shore.
Good.
You know, to get to Ohio or the Caribbean, I thought they would sail west.
Well, that's a big... That Oriental implagam has created a lot of fuss in scholars. I mean, clearly one solution is just to amend the text and say, no, it means occidentem. Because certainly we all want Brendan to be heading west. Right.
Because honestly, if he's heading east from Ireland, he's going to hit Great Britain and then Europe. And
well, he's heading east towards Ireland. So he could have been. So
that's true.
We don't know where he is when he started heading whatever direction he's going.
So he could be going, as it were, clockwise.
He's been all over the place already.
Going back to Ireland, and some scholars make a big point about this. That you, as it were, you may not know it, but in the medieval mind, or the mind of this author, the paradise on earth is just next to Ireland, right? Because they've gone back east to be near Ireland, and that's where they are. But obviously, the alternative is to put it where everybody puts it, which is in the west.
Yeah.
Because really, it's not fair for the Irish to have dibs on God and the earthly paradise.
No, that's
just
right.
Just saying.
I don't see why not.
Well, they don't have it. They just have it near them.
Right. They're skipping a jump away, as it were.
Anyway, the English and the Scottish, so that doesn't do anybody any good. So,
And by the way, these ideas continued to have great power for many centuries thereafter. One of Columbus's diaries, when he's talking about discovering the several mouths of the Orinoco River on the coast of what we now call Venezuela, so that he's pretty sure if you go up those far enough, you'll find Eden. Mm-hmm. You'll find the fountain Eden. You'll find paradise.
Really?
Oh yeah, Columbus is mad as a hatter. It's crazy.
Well, Everybody, they were looking for Brendan's Island in the West up until at least the 18th century. And they thought and everything. Anyway. 22.
William, 28.2 is yours, isn't it?
Yeah, I'll do it. All right. Poroa scandentibus de navi, and so getting out of the ship, viderunt terram spatiosam ac plenam arboribus pomiferis sicut in a tempore autumnali. They saw a spacious land that was full of fruit-bearing trees as though at the time in the season of autumn. Cum autem circuissent illam terram, but when they had walked around, or I would say traversed that land, nihil affuit illis nox, there was no night for them, right? Bruce, is that right? Is that what we decided, Bruce?
Well, that's what I suggested to you this morning.
That's what I thought, right, okay. Accipiebant tantum de pomis quantum volebant et de fontibus vivebant et ita per quadraginta dies perlustrabant totam terram et non poterant finem ilius invenire. They just took as many of the fruit as they wanted, and they drank from the fountains, and thus for 40 days they were wandering the whole land, and they weren't able to find its end. Quadam vero die invenerunt flumen magnum vergentem per medium insulae. One day, they found a big river flowing through the middle of the island. Tunc sanctus Brendanus fratribus suis aet, then said to his brothers, istud flumen non possumus transire. We are not able to cross that river. Et ignoramus magnitudinem ilius terrae. And we don't know the size of that land. Mm-hmm. Cum haec intra se volvissent statim, while they were thinking about those things within themselves at once.
Yeah, this is another one of these pluperfects, right? Mm-hmm. For no apparent reason. And haec, we've actually glossed over this a couple of times. William said these things. So haec is hike, meaning this is a neuter. This is a neuter plural. Mm-hmm. So all these things. Statim? Why were they thinking about it at once?
Well, I wonder if the statim shouldn't go. There shouldn't be a comma after volvissent. Statim immediately.
Oh, that would be doing awesome. It.
So statim. That's why I'm going to put the comma there.
Statim, yeah, that
would. Occurrit illis obiam. Behold. Or immediately, behold, a young man runs up to them and meets them, osculans illos cum magna laetitia, kissing them with great happiness, et singulos nominatim appellabat atque dicebat, and calling them individually by name, and he said, or he was saying, beati qui habitant in domo tua, blessed are those who live in your house, in saeculum saeculi laudabunt te, they will praise you forever and ever. Which is presumably a quotation from somewhere, but I don't seem to have a note on it.
Sounds like the Psalms again. They're always quoting.
Beati qui.
Right, that sounds totally. Anyway, but.
Yeah, if somebody can look it up, as you've noticed, I keep flipping in and out because I have some kind of terrible combination of technical problems this evening.
Okay.
Some of which may very well be user error.
Hmm.
Looks like Psalm 83.
I prefer to assume it's Google being evil.
Bert, I'm sorry, did you have a reference?
Sorry, that's very kind of you.
Looks like Psalm 83.
Okay.
Thank you.
Beati qui, does it say, but it doesn't say in saeculum saeculi, does it?
Yeah, it does say that.
It does.
Hmm.
Okay, so it's Jerome being weird.
Okay.
Or whoever preceded Jerome. I think Psalms is one of those things that Jerome actually didn't translate himself.
Okay.
But I don't remember. Not all of the Old Testament did Jerome translate himself. There were some existing translations that he more or less left.
But it says in Siculum Siculi in the Vulgate that you found, Bert.
Yes.
That's really interesting, actually.
Okay.
Well, because I looked this up, this question of, you know, in Sicula Siculorum.
Mm-hmm.
And it says, yes, all over the New Testament, but the New Testament only. And you've just discovered a slight variation in the Psalms.
Hmm. I have no comment on that at this time. Anybody, we've got four short chapters to go. Anybody want to volunteer?
Are you sure it was in, I'm just Google searching, but Google's coming up with in Cycula Cyculorum for Psalm 84.
No, but not Cyculorum.
Not the singular, the plural.
Right, exactly.
Which is what we would expect to hear.
Mm. Yeah.
Okay. I revert to my previous question.
Have we heard any volunteers yet? Or are they just going to make us squirm right here?
I'll do some.
As is their due.
I'll do some.
Okay.
Thank you.
Cum hec dixisset, when he had said this, ait ad sanctum Brendanum, or when he had said these things, he said to St. Brendan, Ecce terram quam quaesisti per multum tempus. Behold the land which you have sought for a long time, for much time, for a great time.
Mm-hmm.
Ideo non potuisti statim illam invenire. Because of this, you were not able to find it immediately. Quia Deus voluit tibi ostendere diversa sua secreta in oceano magno, because God was willing to show you his various secrets, or various of his secrets,
mm-hmm.
in the great ocean.
Which doesn't seem like the same kind of secretis, his secret stores we were
talking about this
a little while ago.
Yeah, this is secret things, secret wonders,
Hidden
things, but there are hidden things.
Hey, look, I think Paul has come along.
Oh, hello.
Yep. Hi, guys.
Mm-hmm.
And Jamie, I
figured out how to get on.
You're absolutely right to do that hike as these things. I don't know if you're planning on taking the Latin AP exam. I don't know, you know, but if you are, they do want you to do it as these things and not this.
And okay.
So you're absolutely right to do that.
Yeah, yeah.
They will mark this wrong. And those the translation section on the AP exam is horrible. The grading is really mean, because if you get anything in that, they divide, I don't know if you're planning on doing it, but they do the chunking, and so if you get anything in that 18th of that section wrong, any part of it, that whole 18th of it is marked wrong. So.
Oh, no.
So definitely want to say these things and not this.
Well,
okay.
This is crazy.
Thank you.
Yep, it's a very easy way to grade,
dodging,
but it's
the cat.
So unfair to students. Because you could know everything and just get one teeny thing wrong, and they'll mark that whole thing wrong.
And that piece of that sentence is...
the whole thing is wrong.
Oh, that's a shame.
Yeah.
Revertere itaque ad terram nativitatis tuae. Therefore, return to the land of your birth, to your homeland. Portans tecum de fructibus terrae istius, carrying with you some of the fruits of this land, et de gemmis, and of the jewels.
Mm-hmm.
Quantum potest tua navicula capere, as much as your boat can carry or can handle. Apropinquant enim...
Paula, you know we're at 28.3, right in the middle?
I did not. That's what I was about to ask.
Okay.
Sorry.
That's okay.
Apropinquant enim dies peregrinationis tuae, for the... days, for the day of your, for the days of your wandering are approaching,
mm-hmm.
ut dormias cum patribus tuis, in order that you may sleep with your fathers. In other words, this is wandering in the metaphorical sense. You're wandering on the earth. You're being alive.
Mm-hmm.
Post multa vero curricula temporum declarabitur ista terra successoribus vestris. So after many, many circuits of time, this land will be declared to your successors quando Christianorum supervenerit persecutio, when a persecution of Christians shall come to pass. Istud flumen quod videtis, that river which you see, dividit istam insulam, divides this island. Sicut modo apparet vobis matura fructibus, just as the ripeness of fruits. Just as it appeared to you ripe with fruits.
Yeah, the island, right.
Yes, that makes sense. Ita omni tempora permanet, thus it always remains, thus it remains for all time, sine ulla umbra noctis, without any shadow of night. Lux enim ilius est Christus, for the light of it is Christ, and that's from Revelation.
Good.
Wait, that's a quote of Revelation?
Yes.
Okay.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Four lines up from the bottom, declarabitur. Declared, yeah, maybe, but this is really more made clear, as in the sense of
revealed.
After many cycles of time, this land will be revealed to your successors, meaning your descendants, or your successors.
You know that revealed to your descendants in the time of the persecution of the Christians, probably, I would guess that would be a major weapon in the armory of the people who think this is America and take it all very literally, because if you think about, you know, all the different people that have come to America for religious reasons, it actually kind of makes the Ohio River thing make a little more sense.
Yeah. You know?
That just occurred to me. If you're going to be that kind of commentator, which I know you're not, but if one were, that would be a rather fun thing.
Well, there is this notion that Irish clergymen went west from Iceland when the Norse came.
Really?
There's actually some evidence for that.
There was a settlement on Iceland before the Vikings got there.
Right, but then there's some evidence that they then went to Greenland and Labrador and places. Not Ohio, but I'm sure they would like Ohio better.
Ohio is warmer.
Yeah, right. Yes.
All right, who wants to volunteer? Thank you, Jamie. Who wants to volunteer?
No problem.
8.4? Back to you, Bruce. Want me to do it?
No, I'll do it. We're at 28.4.
Mm-hmm.
For our fans around the world, for all eternity, heaven help us. Tunc vero acceptis de fructibus terrae et omnibus generibus generum. Then, when they had taken the fruits of the earth and all types of gems or jewels, dimisoque benedicto procuraturae et juvene, and having sent away the blessed steward and this youth who popped up out of nowhere. Sanctus Brandanus cum suis fratribus ascendit naviculum et caput navigare per medium Caliginis. St. Brendan with his brothers re-embarked. They got up on the little boat, they re-embarked, and they began to sail through the midst of the fog. Cum altum per transiscent venerant ad insulam quae vocatur deliciarum. And when they had passed through it, meaning the fog, I take it, they came to the island which is called the Island of Joys, of Delight.
Mm-hmm.
Ibique trierum dierum hospitium peregerunt, and there they sought out hospitality for 3 days, 3 days of hospitality of 3 days, literally. There they sought out 3 days hospitality. Atque accepta benedictione sanctus Brendanus, recto itinere ad locum suum reversus est. And after having taken a blessing, St. Brendan returned to his own place, meaning to his place where he started, by a direct route, let's call it that.
Good. I have a note that says it's not the same as the Insula Deliciosa in 1.4.
Mm-hmm.
Some scholars say it flatly is, some scholars say flatly it isn't. I was just copying a scholar who said it flatly wasn't, but
that's what you do. Then you pick your side, and if somebody challenges, you double down and say, what is your evidence for the opposite? or you just say what you just said in a slightly higher volume.
That's my second strategy. The second thing is my strategy. I'm happy to embrace uncertainty, and I just want to report what people think about all of this.
What is the reasoning for saying that it's not the same as the one before?
Well, it's partly that it's different language, partly that he doesn't seem to say that it's the one that he went to before.
Yes, just that it isn't quite the same word.
And then it also gets into this evidence for the Irish versions of these kinds of stories and trying to match up the Latin with the Irish, at which point I'm outside of my level of having a clue, and so I just shrug my shoulders.
By the way, I have a question. On the note to Gemma, note 9, you say it's presumably metaphorical for fruits, but I don't see why. They're gathering fruits and gems, and I don't see any reason why the promised land shouldn't be full of precious stones.
Right.
It is promised land.
Right. Bruce made the same point. I don't have an opinion about that either. But Gemma can also mean the buds of flowers. I never thought of the promised land having the jewelry. That just seems weird.
But if you think of like the city of gold with the gates of pearl, it's definitely a part of the imagery of, you know, the New Jerusalem and all that.
Yeah.
It's just related.
True. I don't know where that comes from.
Taking them away.
That's all. You're referring to Revelation again, right?
Right. This is definitely, I think, supposed to be, at least in part, the New Jerusalem of Revelation sort of turned into an island.
Right.
Because of that about Christ being its light and all that.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That portion about Christ being light as a quotation is actually, I think, really important here.
Mm-hmm. All right. Good. I shrug my shoulders at that, too. I'm doing a lot of shoulder shrugging.
But as I said to William in my notes, sometimes a jewel is just a jewel.
Mm-hmm. All right. Anybody want to do 29.1? Almost the end?
I will try.
Okay.
Thank you.
The brothers, however, received him or took him up with most joyfully. Can I make that sort of adverbially, most joyfully? Glorifying God.
I think it is adverbial, isn't it?
Yeah, it's an adverb.
Right.
Who so loved them that he was not willing to deprive them from the sight of their father.
Good.
Whose absence they had been deprived of for so long.
I think absentia is ablative. By the absence of whom they
They had been deprived for so long.
Did I hear someone say no?
No, I'm saying ablative. That makes sense.
Okay, so by the absence of whom they had been deprived for so long, then...
Yeah, that or body is interesting because that's the same verb you use for being orphaned.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Then the aforesaid blessed man, rejoicing in the love of them...
Mm-hmm.
Told everything that had befallen that was recorded in the trip. Had befallen them in the trip.
I think it's even weirder than that, and that's why it's hard to see. I think it's everything he remembered that had happened in the trip.
Right.
So we're not exactly sure what of all of this he told everybody.
But presumably, somebody remembered, or else it wouldn't be in the story.
Somebody's claiming this knowledge, but it does say he told them everything. He told whatever he remembered had happened.
Fallen on the trip.
Yeah.
And then this next bit, and how many wonders of miracles God had deemed worthy to extend to him?
Yes,
exactly.
Perfect. And
okay.
Finish. That was great, Victoria. No, speak now or forever hold your peace. Jen, you know you want to.
I'll be glad to.
William doesn't want to do another one.
I find this is the saddest one.
I agree. I think these last two paragraphs are really quite sort of, elegiacally moving. I agree.
I don't want to get all emotional on the internet.
All right. Postrelo etiam locatatem obitus ilius, certa attestatione notavit. Finally, also, he noted the speed of his death with a definite testimony. Secundum juvenis praedictum. According to the prediction of the young man, in terra repromissionis sanctorum on the promised land. Quod etiam rei probavit eventus. Which thing also the outcome proved to be true.
Yeah, exactly.
Excellent. I like that outcome.
Yeah.
A rare case where the Latin and good idiomatic English match perfectly.
Quia cunctis posse bene dispositis, because with everything having been well disposed after him, paro inter jacente temporis intervallo, with a short interval of time. Interspersed, lying in between. Mm-hmm. The sacramentis munitus divinis, fortified by the divine sacraments, inter manus discipulorum, among the hands of his disciples, students, gloriosi magravit ad dominum. He crossed over to the Lord in a glorious manner. Mm-hmm. Qui est honor et gloria in saecula saeculorum, the Lord to whom there is honor and glory forever and ever. Amen. Amen. Explicit fiat.
We finished.
All right, we finished.
Explicit.
Was that 2.5 hours?
Looks like it.
Depends on your equipment.
That's a lot of Latin.
I didn't even notice.
It's like a seminar, only with, like, way more irritating audio. I think probably, Jamie, you're the only person that might need to be told this. Real life classes in college are way more fun than this because I should say, the human connection is way better than internet connections, still.
Yes.
Especially when Google is evil.
Right. They may change.
They're not supposed to be.
That may change, but at the moment.
I doubt it.
It is nice to teach without the audio weirdos.
In other words, if you like this, you might really enjoy college.
Right.
I'm looking forward to it.
All right. So thanks, everybody. And it's nice to meet you all. Send me your thoughts about any of this, what we should do next summer, if anything, whether there's any point, who knows. But it's all been very interesting. It's been fun getting to know you all and re-know you in some cases. Like it's great having like my alums and former students and stuff, but it's really nice to meet total strangers. Anyone else got anything to say? I'll take just, other than that, we can just stop and communicate by email in the usual internet-y ways, right?
Well, I'd like to say thank you, William and Bruce. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Plurimas gratias for Bisago.
This is really huge fun to do. It's a real fun.
Have a great semester for those of you who are having semesters, right? Mm-hmm. And great year for everybody else.
And who knows, maybe we'll appear again next June.
I hope so.
That would be great. I hope so.
Take care. Good night. Have a wonderful year.
Good night, everyone.
Bye.
Thank you so much.
Bye-bye.